this is the day that you have made. And we shall rejoice and be glad in it. We are glad when they said unto us, God, we came right into the house of the Lord. Father God, we thank you right now in the name of Jesus for being good, for being great, and for being right.
Yes.
There's nobody like you in all the earth. We bless your holy and your righteous name, God, for the protection you have given us throughout the night. Allow us to sleep, God, peacefully, and wake up, God, in our right minds, God, in the name of Jesus. God, we thank you right now in the name of Jesus that there was no sad news given about your people on last night. Father God, we just bless you for being a keeping, God. We thank you for being a God of another chance, God. We thank you for being sovereign, oh God. We thank you for being our Lord. We thank you for being our deliverer. We thank you for being our redeemer, God. Redeeming us time after time, cleanses us and renewing us, God, and restoring us, God. As we grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Jesus Christ, Father, we give you that glory, honor, and praise on today. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the opportunity to be in your house, to bless your name, Lord. Father, we just pray that you would have your way in this service on today. We pray that your spirit will move, God, mightily upon all hearts and souls in the name of Jesus. We pray that there be no restriction in the spirit, but Lord, in the name of Jesus, have your way in this house on this morning. God, we make this house a house of prayer. We make our hearts a house of prayer, that we will worship you in spirit and truth on today. Lord, we pray, God, no limitations, but let liberty reign in this place. For where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, God. Father, someone needs to hear you today. Someone needs their lives changed today. Someone needs a breakthrough today. Someone needs a deliverance today. And we know that you are able to do it. We know that you are able to do exceedingly, abundantly above all we can ask or think. We know that there is nothing too hard for you, Father. And so, Lord, I pray today as your worship, as worship go forth before you, as the word go forth before you in the name of Jesus, let hearts be turned to you. Even as we prepare our hearts for the word today, we pray that the word of the Lord will speak directly to our present spiritual condition. Cause our lives to align up with you, Lord. We come against all hindrance and distraction by man, by spirit, even by technology. We pray there be no confusion. We pray there be no hindrance in the name of Jesus. But all things will flow decently and in order in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we just ask that you would have your way on this morning. Move upon the worship team. Move upon our bishop as he breaks the word. Move upon the congregation as they surrender worship and praise unto you. Let healing take place in this place. Let there be deliverance, God. Let there be salvation. Let the hearts of your people cry out unto you, God. It's not about us, God. It's not about man. We're not here for no show. We're not here for no performance. But we're here to lift up the name of Jesus. But in the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Father, right now, we just thank you, God, as you are lifting limitations throughout this city and this state. Help us not to go back to our old ways, but help us to run after you, God, with all our hearts and with all our minds. Help us to run after you, God, with sincerity and true, Father. In the name of Jesus, break strongholds and habits. Things that's been on your people's mind, God, break even today. Change attitudes, change motives. Let there be deliverance, oh God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. You are great, God. You are holy, God. You are righteous, God. You are strong and mighty, God. You are mighty in battle, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that even through this pandemic, Jesus, you've been keeping everybody that is assigned to this local assembly. You've been keeping our children. You've been keeping the spouses. You've been keeping the husbands, the wives, God. Our elders, God. From the youngest to the old. And Lord, we just stop out and say thank you once again. We're not asking for nothing material, God. We just want to say thank you for your loving kindness. It's better than life, Jesus. And you said in your word that with all life, you will satisfy us. Give us good days to look forward to. For the thoughts towards us are thoughts of peace and not of evil. To give us an expected end. Father, have your way today. Have your way today. Move by your spirit. Cover us to your blood, even as we worship in this place. Let our worship be sincere, a spirit and a truth, Father. Lord, we honor you today. For there is nobody like you, Jesus. Hallelujah, God. In the name of Jesus.
Thank you. thanking God for his people that are gathered at this place of worship. Those of you that are joining us on Facebook and other media, we welcome you to our worship service on this Lord's Day morning. I was in a very interesting conversation with a gentleman this weekend, and he was trying to persuade me that we must keep the Sabbath holy. And I said to him, I said, I'd rather keep every day holy. And he said, but God made the commandment. God wrote them. You know that God wrote the commandment on the table of stones. Everybody know that?
Yes, sir.
And when Moses got down to the end of the mountain, and he saw the wickedness of the people, he took the stones. Then in the New Testament, which is what we are living in now, the dispensation of grace, when the church was established, they met on the first day of the week. Give God thanks in everything you do.
Yes.
He don't want your seventh day praise. He wants your every day praise. He don't want your seventh day worship. He wants your everyday worship. And what's the best way to start off your week? Not on Saturday, but on Sunday, the first day of the week, you're lifting your voices. You are assembling yourself in the house of God. And you're lifting your voices and hands in praise. I don't know about you, but I feel good giving God the first. Thank you, Jesus. God bless you. Thank God for this little bit of release. A lot of you have been at home for the last couple of months. But the team was here every Sunday. We still had to work. This place was fired up like
yes.
packed in a prayer.
Yes.
I tell you one thing, we might have been quarantined, but God wasn't quarantined.
Yes.
And he's still not quarantined. In everything, give him praise. Because he's worthy of the praise. Let's go into our word today. I thank God again for an opportunity to serve those of you that are visiting with us today. We thank God for you. I want you to invite your attention, make notes of our steady text for the day. It is found in the book of Exodus, chapter 33, verses 18 through 23. Exodus, chapter 33, verses 18 through 23. And in the book of Matthew, chapter 17, verses 1 through 9. Matthew chapter 17, 1 through 9. And our last scripture is found in the book of Romans, chapter number 12, verses 1 through 3. Romans chapter 12, 1 through 3. Great is thou faithful. Stop by this one place and I was looking for a hoopty, cheap tee, something with no payment. Wasn't planning on paying the arm and a leg. The first place I stopped at that old hoopty there asked it, "It's okay, but you're asking too much." Rode up a couple of miles down the road, and here go this truck sitting on the left side of the highway. I pulled on the side and ran over, and it was the right price. So I called the man, and he didn't answer, and he didn't have voicemail. So I texted him. I said, "I'm interested in this pickup." And we went on to Wasilla. We got into Wasilla. The man called. He said, "Yes, he's available." I said, "How is the engine and transmission?" He said, "They are fine. The engine got a little skip to it. Maybe it needs some spark plugs, some wires." I said, "I want to look at it." Went back. Just make a long story short, I went back. I looked at it. They told me what they wanted. I told them what I would give them. They said, "Okay, we can deal with that."
Okay.
And so we went back home, picked up everything we needed, paid for the truck, got the title, drove the truck home. Let me show you what happened. See, it was skipping going home. I knew it was going to skip. Got home, put some spark plugs in it, put some wires in it, drove it down the road, and it runs like a sewing machine. And the songs are great as our faith. All that I needed, now had.
Yes, sir.
Just a few days before that, a guy parked the same truck, 2 years older, by the house. And he wanted to sell it to me, and I asked him what he wanted. I said, "I'll give you this." He said, "No, I can't take that." I said, "What's the closest you can get?" And he said a number, and I said another number. He said, "Oh, I don't know how to think on it." That's a good thing. So the Lord allowed me to get a truck, 2 years newer, for one half the price of the older truck.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
All I have needed now is an apple pie. Stand upon a rock. stands by me, and thou shalt stand upon a rock. Moses, writing in the 18th verse of Exodus, says that he said, I beseech thee, show me your glory. Show me your glory. Glory is beauty and power and honor. It's a quality of God's character that is emphasized, that emphasizes his greatness and authority. The word in the Bible is used in three different senses. Number one, it's used as God's moral beauty and perfection of character. This divine quality alone is beyond man's understanding. All people fall short of his glory. For the scripture says we all have sinned and fall short of his glory. Secondly, God's moral beauty and perfection as a visible presence. God's glory is not a substance. At times, God does reveal his perfection to man in a visible way. Every now and then, God will show up and show out. He followed the children of Israel as a pillar of cloud by day and as a fire by night. The Lord delivered the Israelite through the Red Sea. These are his glory as he manifests his presence before mankind. Especially in the Old Testament, in the tabernacle, God's glory was always there. And when you look at the tabernacle and how it was designed to invoke or ask the presence of God to come in. But when we move over into the New Testament, Christ now shares his divine glory with his followers. We, as the children of God, when we live right, when we do what God says, the people see the glory of God in our lives.
Yes, Lord.
And the third thing that his glory represents, and I like this one, is praise. At times, God's glory may mean the honor and audible praise which his creatures give to him. As I observed the praises that went up in this place today, God was getting the glory out of those praises. I wish somebody stay with me for a little bit. And so as we move on down to our noted text, because Moses wanted to see God's glory. He wanted God to manifest himself to him. God says to Moses, behold, there is a place by me, and thou shalt stand upon a rock. And when I pass by, my glory passes by.
My God.
I will put my put thee in a clip on the rock, and will cover thee with my hand while I pass by. In other words, if you look at me, you can't live because my glory is so powerful. But what I'm going to do for you, Moses, as I pass by, when I get past by you, I will remove my hands from off your eyes, and you shall see my hind parts. I wish somebody stay with me for a little bit. So he puts Moses upon this cliff, and he puts him upon a rock. And then we move over to Matthew. I know the text says, and Peter says, Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. Anytime God shows up, it's a good place to be in the house.
Yeah.
For the last 40-something years, over 46 years, every time the door of the house was open, I tried my best to get into the house of God. Because you never know what God might do in a service. God is just like Forrest Gump says, a box of chocolate. You never know what you might get. Some of you came here today expecting one thing, but by the time you leave out here today, God may do something unexpected. God may do something out of the ordinary. God may do something miraculous, because you never know how God's going to show up. That's why you need to come to the house of God. You know, I enjoy broadcasting and putting things over on Facebook and allowing you to be able to still hear the word of God. But there's nothing like being in the house of the Lord. That's why Peter said, when he went up on the Mount of Transfiguration, when he saw saw Jesus, Moses, and Elijah, he said, Lord, it is good to be here. Anytime you see God transform himself, it brings about that happy feeling, that good feeling of praise, because you know something good is about to happen. I wish we didn't have all these masks today so you can tell your neighbor. But even with your mask on, just look at them and say, it's good to be here. And then in Romans it says, in verse number 2 of Romans 12, and the Lord says, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed. Glory means transformed. It means transition. And when Jesus was on the Mount of Transfiguration, it means that he was transformed out of one image into another. And so the Lord is telling us to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Don't be transformers, but be ye transformed. In other words, as you progress in Christ, you should continually be changed and be molded the way that God wants you to be. You shouldn't be the same way you were a year ago or 10 years ago. There should be a progression, a progressive move of in your life where you will continuously be more like Jesus. Yeah. The Bible says that we must decrease, but he must increase. That is transformation. That's the way when people look at you, they no longer see you, John, Mary, Sue, but they see Jesus. I wish somebody follow me today. And so we got this individual that is placed in a cliff on a rock. We got this other man with his other co-partners. They're at the Mount of Transfiguration, and Peter says, it is good to be here. And then Paul picks it up in Romans and tells us, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. I want to leave a topic with you today. It is good to be here. Look at somebody and say, it's good to be here. And come on, say it like you mean. It is good to be here. You got your mask on so you can scream, saying it's good to be here.
Good to be here.
Thank you, Jesus. I don't know about you, but these last 2 months, although we were here every Sunday, it's nothing like having the people of God in the house of God. Because at home, you know, you're looking at Facebook, you probably got a little Coke in your hand, some popcorn, didn't you, at the movie. But in the house of God, you do show some respect.
Yeah.
You do show some reverence to a move of God. I don't know about you, but I just can't get out of TV when I get in person. I can't feel what I feel in the house of God at home. I don't care how good the program might be. I don't care how powerful the message might be. But it's just something about being here.
Yeah.
And I can't even tell you today that it is good to be here.
Yes,
it's just good to be here. Think about 80-something thousand people are dead and gone. But you walked in here this morning. You got some activity on your lips. You got the blood still running and warm in your veins. And God has been good to you. God has done so much for you. God has blessed you, your family. Nobody got the virus. You are yet hanging on. That's why it's good to be here. Standing upon the rock.
Yes.
The Lord says to Moses, I will put you in the cliff and put you, and by me, I'm going to let you stand on the rock.
Yes.
39 years ago, when Mike was about 3 years old, I used to take him with me to Broad River to fish.
Uh-oh.
He was only 3 years old. Broad River is a river that has lots of water. It's probably as wide as from here almost down to the bridge. Mm. And I would take him, and I didn't have a wife, but she can handle it. She'd be hollering and screaming, and watch out and be careful and that stuff. But I would tell you, we would skip the rocks.
Uh-huh.
We would go all the way in the middle part of Broad River, where the big largemouth bass are. And I would set them on a rock, and I would fish. What is it about a rock?
Mm.
What is it about a rock?
Solid.
You feel secure. I don't care what's going on around you.
Say that, Bishop.
And you can stay on the rock.
Stay on the rock. Jesus.
Although I was fishing and I had my little son, my only son at that time, with me, I didn't worry about him because I specifically told him, stay on the rock.
Stay on the rock.
Jesus.
Teach it, Bishop.
Because the Moses, and he wants to see the glory of God. And God says, you can't stand my glory, but I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll put you on this rock, and as I come by, I will cover your eyes so you can at least feel and experience the glory as it goes by.
Yeah.
No matter what's happening, it is safe to be on the rock. In these last few months, that's been testing for us. Has been anxious, made us anxious, and some of us got nervous, and some of us got worried, but I came to tell you, just stay on the rock.
Yes,
because if you stay on the rock, it's going to be all right. I know we have to go out and we got to buy our food, and we got to go to work, some of us, and we got to do things where we are associated with other folks, and you don't know where they've been, you don't know what they've been involved in, you don't know whether they've been exposed or not have been exposed, but all I can tell you, just stay on the rock, because if you're on the rock, there is safety on the rock. Once you move off the rock, you just lost your safety.
Jesus.
But as long as you stay on the rock, and I heard somebody said that Jesus is the rock.
Yes.
Somebody else wrote a song that my soul been anchored in the Lord. As long as I stay on the rock, I don't have to worry about it. I know everything's going to be all right. And the virus may come, and if we live long enough, something else gonna come. All my life things were coming. But all my life I was standing on the rock. Every time I stood on the rock, guess what? I came out all right. Because there is safety on the rock. Holler at somebody and say, stand on the rock.
Stand on the rock. That's Jesus.
Jesus help me. It's good to be here. I feel as good as a termite in a sawmill.
Preach it, Bishop.
Thank you, Jesus. Second thing I want to leave with you today, being in a good place when things turn good. Being in a good place when things turn good.
Yes, Jesus.
And now you remember that Jesus didn't take everybody up on the mountain.
Yeah.
He only took three of them. Three of his disciples. Because sometimes where you go, everybody can't go.
That's right.
Jesus. And sometimes the vision that God shows you, you can't tell everybody because everybody can't see.
Yeah.
And so you got to be careful who you take with you. Because something good might happen.
All right.
And you might have the wrong folks with you.
My God.
And so when the people of God come together, what a time it's going to be. So Jesus takes them up, and when they get up on this mountain, a cloud comes down, and Jesus is transformed before their eyes. And they also saw two men that have been long dead, Moses and Elijah, also appear. Man, what a time that should have been. For you to look at somebody that you heard about. You heard about Moses, how he brought the children out of the land of Egypt, how he crossed the Red Sea, how he spoke to the rock and touched the rock, gave water, how he called down manna from heaven. All the things that Moses had done, you read about it in the book. And all of a sudden, this man that had died years ago is standing before you. Being in a good place when things turn good. Thank you, Jesus. Again, I work with it a little bit. And so when you know that the people of God is coming together and doing this together, because something good is about to happen.
All right.
Now that's why we're showing up here today. Because I just got a feeling that something good is about to happen.
Yes. Yes.
Acceptable and perfect will of God.
Come on,
over the last few months, I tell you, a transformation has taken place.
Yes, Jesus.
I just can't explain it. What God has done in the last few months. Yes.
Jesus.
Change has taken place.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
And if you're still the same place,
same
condition, you were 3 months ago.
Jesus.
We need to pray for you.
Yeah, yeah.
We need to pour some oil on you.
Yeah, yeah.
But if anybody in this building
Jesus.
Feels like your life has been changed, change. He wants the church to change. He wants us not to be like we used to. felt the quickening. I felt the move of God. Although I was not, it will come near. But I felt God moving in His people. I felt Him doing a great work. I felt Him that you are not the same. Praise God, but you are not the same. You might be at home, but God is doing a great work. You never be the same. You might have been a transfer, but God's gonna transfer. You might not allow me to be transformed, but He's gonna make you transform. He's gonna take you to a place that you never turn back. You had a good trust. It might not be that.
Oh!
you have at home. And the way you look at this broadcast is what you're doing right now. But so if you're a child of the broadcast, and you're glad to be in the house of God again, I want you to give God everything you got.
Give us praise.